I'm going to introduce Linda Vaughn. She's also my sister from a long, long time ago. And she's a seer, a prophetess, and I'm going to say a revivalist. She's got the spirit of revival and the breath of God inside of her. Amen. So we're going to invite her to come up here right now. Can we welcome her right now?
God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. That's a real word. It's substance. It's blessing. It's life. And I'm going to talk until my volume is up, and then Bob, come back. It's up. Okay, Bob, come back. Father, in Jesus' name, you've done this. It's finished in the spirit, and we're going to see it in reality. Amen? Yes. Say yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. I believe you, God.
I believe God.
I believe that you're sewing us together by your blood. I believe that we're one with Israel, that we are engrafted. I believe that you're sending Bob to release the word of the Lord. Say yes.
Yes.
I believe. Now say, God bless you, Bob.
God bless you,
go
Bob.
With the Lord, Bob. Shut up, Bob. No, go ahead and declare for yourself, too. I would if I were you. Go with the Almighty, Bob.
Yeah, the Almighty, Bob.
All right, now we're going to practice. Go with the Almighty, Bob. Go where He sends you with the word of the Lord. And be increased in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. And may the great favor of the Lord rest upon you. And may you leave Holy Spirit tracks by every footstep you take. May you go with the fierce love of the Almighty. God bless you. 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 In the name of the Most High God. Now somebody give God glory in this house. Hallelujah. So we say that there's no division with this nation, Israel, our mother, our sister, our beloved, our friend. I don't know how to fold the flag. Don't be offended in me. I'm very sorry. But I bless this union in the name of the Most High God, and we just say we go with you in spirit. All the intercessors, stand up. Intercessors, you know who you are. Stand up and tell the Lord, put the word in my mouth to pray for Bob for this journey, and I will pray what you say in Jesus' name. I put you under the blood of Jesus and say, do it. Be faithful. Give God glory in this house. All right. Amen. 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 Okay. So this is eternal life, to know Father and His Son, Jesus Christ, whom He has sent. Amen? Amen. This is eternal life, to know our Heavenly Father, to know Him and His Son, Jesus Christ, whom He has sent. He's been stirring so many encounters that I've had with Him tonight. I was standing in the universe. Now, that's not really possible, but it is. I was standing in the universe, and the Lord was standing across from me, brilliant beyond the sunlight. Beautiful. And I'm standing there, you know, like with the big, you know, the big balloon over my head, like the cartoon character, thinking, what? And there He stood in all His glory. And He did like this. And stars came shooting out of His hands and went behind Him to where they were going to live. And then I found that in the Word, and I was all right with it, because I got to know that I'm seeing Him. And then He looked me right in the eyes and He said, and you will receive power, beloved, when Holy Spirit comes upon you. And then a rainbow came out of His mouth. And I was just like, what? And then I was back on the floor in my bedroom where I'd been praying. Whether I was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. I just know that I was so full of Holy Spirit and the glory of God was on me, and I couldn't raise my head, my hand, my foot. I couldn't get up. And I was praying with Elaine on the phone and told her exactly what had happened. And then I said, we need to ask Holy Spirit to come upon us. This is some years ago, 2010, I think. And I was so afraid that it would kill me when Holy Spirit came upon me, because what I have just seen in the power and majesty of the King. So quaking and drunk, I'm on the floor. Oh, come upon me, Holy Ghost. Well, I think he had. But I wasn't in my sound mind. I was in the Spirit. Well, he's come upon me at different times in my life. What he has for us tonight is encounter. Hey, Adam, you've been in my upper room and been encountered by the Lord. I live with him. I live for him. In 2005, he said to me, beloved, you take me everywhere we go, you introduce me to everyone, but you are afraid to turn and face me because you're afraid of what I think of you. And I went, oh my gosh, that's right. I am. I was so afraid of what he thought of me. I had lived a far less than perfect and ideal life. And so you know what I said? Turn me to face you. You do it, God. I don't have the courage. In 2006, I left City Union Mission in Kansas City, went to Seattle Union Gospel Mission for a work there. And then the Lord brought me back in December of 2006 to Independence. He said, now we're going to do something different. What's that, Lord? He said, well, our time together is going to go from an hour a day to 2 to 4 to 8 to 16 to 24 to unending. And I thought, well, what in the world would I do? I mean, how does that look? I'm just going to, what? I don't even know. I had no grid. And so I had a worship room in my house. And my computer was in there, my sister back there, and she can tell you all of this. She witnessed everything. And I had a sofa in there and my recliner and music all the time. And I would go in and be with the Lord for an hour or two, and then I noticed that the days were changing because I was changing, and my hour went to 2 to 4, and I wasn't even paying attention. And then came the day when Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, come in and close the door. We're going to stay in here. I was like, what could I possibly do in there? I probably won't get it right. I shouldn't. But I couldn't tell the Lord no. And I was really, little tiny hallway, pacing up and down. I don't know what to do in there. I'm afraid to go in there. I don't know what to do. And he had been saying to me, when you're washing the dishes, talk to me. Oh, what does that look like? What would I say to you? You know, when you're working in the yard, talk to me. Really? What? You want to talk when I'm in the yard? When you're doing anything, talk to me. In other words, he was breaking through my holy moments to live a holy life. Amen. He was breaking through my pieces of encounters to give me a lifetime encounter. There are people shaking their heads because you know, because that's how you live. So as I finally mustered the courage, I'm standing right in front of the door, but I couldn't put my hand to the knob and I was terrified to go in. And you know what he said? Oh, beloved, let's hang out. And I went, hang out? Man, I can hang out all day. Okay, let's hang out. So I went in, I closed the door. And I'm gonna share just how religious I was. Really religious. You know, as I'm in there, I turn the music on, I'm worshiping, I'm dancing, I'm singing, I'm with the Lord. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. His presence swirling. Then he says, lay down. lay down, lay down. So I lay down on the hardwood floor with the little oriental rug on it, and it wasn't very comfortable. So I'm laying there like this. How long is this going to last? And I was so uncomfortable. It seemed like 100 hours went by and I couldn't turn my head. I was, oh my God. And I said, can I roll over? What? And he said, yeah. So, okay, I'm going to try this thing, you know. Okay. First, I'm on the nose. Okay, that's not going to work. Okay, this thing. Okay, I'll try that thing. No, that was even worse yet. Could I have a pillow? And you know what he said? Oh, beloved, get comfortable. Yes. What? Man, I'm piling up blankets and pillows, making a big pallet on the floor. Ha! And I lay down. And I'm just laying there. What am I supposed to be doing? Right. Religious people do stuff. That's right. I learned that because I used to do stuff. And in there, I wasn't allowed to do anything. He said, just lay down, just rest. And after doing that for some days, he was overtaking me. Because my obedience to lay down brought him upon me. And rest began to overtake me. And so my first few days, I'm sorry I keep making noise with this thing, stop that. Okay. My first few days, I would just lay there, I'd be fully awake and fully alert. But then something happened. And I would go out in the spirit. And I'd be gone for some hours. And I would come back feeling like I just had the best nap of my life. I might go out and have lunch in my kitchen, come back and lay back down and go out in the spirit. It got to where I was out in the spirit anywhere from 15 to 18 hours a day. Wow. Tell him, sis, say that's the truth. That's the truth. It's not humanly possible to do that. Only Jesus can do that. But what he was doing was taking things out of me that had come into me since the fall of Adam and Eve. And he had been saying to me, he said, I'm unburying the hidden treasure in your heart. And I thought, well, that's amazing. I wonder what that is. Huh? It was him. It was him. And I had no idea. I was clueless. I can't wait for that. Whatever it is, it's going to be great. And it was him. And I remember, oh gosh, it was so embarrassing. I had a globe that I had bought at Seattle and I brought it home. And I remember the day the Lord said, get your globe out of the closet, take it off the stand, put your thumb on Israel, your hand and on China and India, and put your left hand on over here on Brazil. It's really hard to hold a globe like that. And I said, okay. And he said, now I want you to dance with the globe. And I thought, okay, well, I rebuke you, Satan, in the name of Jesus. You want me to look ridiculous, and I'm not going to do that. And the Lord said, beloved, get the globe. So I got the globe, and I'm turning on Paul Wilbur. Well, if we're going to do that, let's just do this. Okay, so I begin to dance, and my sister knocks on the door, and so I shove the globe under my shirt. It's like, oh, you can't see this. How stupid is that? Because I was so embarrassed to do that. I was so ashamed. People are going to think I'm ridiculous. And so then I got to her. It didn't matter. She'd come and go. So I was dancing with the globe. And one day he said to me, pray and prophesy over Papua New Guinea. I don't even know if I'm saying that right. But anyway, yeah. And I'd never heard of it. I didn't know where it was. I just knew he said, pray and prophesy. And I said, Father, what do you want? He said, I want salvations. I want miracles, signs, and wonders. He said, and I want my Papua New Guinea bride. Right. And I said, okay. So I had to get on the internet because it's so tiny on the globe. There's no way I could have seen that. So I'm searching on the internet trying to find it. Then I find it on the globe and I put my little thumb on it and I'm holding it's Australia, all that up there. And so I'm praying and I'm dancing and I'm singing and I'm dancing and I'm singing. His spirit came upon me and I began to prophesy over the Papua New Guinea bride. And within a couple of weeks or so, I got a letter can't think of this man's name, Peter Lundgren or something, out of Canada. He had just been to Papua New Guinea right after I'd been praying and prophesying. And he wrote in his newsletter and showed pictures of the amazing miracles, the amazing salvations, and all that God had done. And the Lord said, "You do hear me." And I was like, "Oh, wow." So he was building my confidence. It's like we were going steady. You know, we're going steady. It's right here. It's on my right hand, but it's right there. Yeah, you got one too. Well, so then as our time went on, I began to change. Physically, things were changing. I would feel electricity on my face, on my hands, on my feet. Now, I'd never heard of that. And I thought, this is really, really weird. But I kind of liked it because it was so unusual. I thought it's entertaining. You know, I'd wake up, bzz, 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 and I'd think, wow. He's really like lightning. And one day I woke up and there was a hand that looked like lightning, the size of my hand, going into my hand. And I never saw it come out. Because I went out in the spirit as soon as I saw that. I was like, oh, whew, and I'm gone. The supernatural is more real than the natural, because the natural fades away. The supernatural, if we could see through the veil, and if we believe, we'll see, and the veil gets so sheer until we are living in the natural supernatural with God. Amen? So as I'm lying on the floor, almost 24 hours a day, my mother would come down the street and come in, and she'd open my worship room door. She'd look down and she'd go, "Oh, Jesus, my daughter's lost her mind. Oh, my God, help her." And I'd lay there, "Hi, Mom." Ooh, bam, I'm out. And I couldn't even get up to comfort her. I couldn't do anything to help her. She thought, she has lost her mind. Don't you need to go out and do something? Or don't you want to just go to a movie or just do that? No, I didn't want to do anything. I slept on the floor in that room. I lived there. It was almost 2 years. And Jesus was taking religion out of me and unveiling himself in my heart. And I was being changed. I remember sitting on the sofa one day after I'd spent some time with the Lord all these months, and I heard this high-pitched hum. And I thought, what is that? And then I realized I was vibrating. And he said to me, "I've changed your frequency." And I went, "Huh?" If it's happened, you know. If you haven't happened, if it hasn't happened to you, it's a little leap of faith. But it is the truth. I just got another frequency change, Pentecost. Holy Ghost. Now the frequency changes apply to walking in the supernatural. Jesus walked through walls because of the frequency that he was. The closer we get to God, the more we are filled with him, the more we do what Jesus did, right?
Yes. Right?
The more holy that we live, the closer we get to God. So the Lord had to tell me what holy is and what holy isn't. And I love what Heidi Baker said. She said she learned from the Lord that if the Lord told her to sweep her house and she did it with joy and love, that was holy. Yes. If she went out to raise the dead, that was holy. Whatever she did, and she did unto the Lord, that was holy. Amen. And he was changing my mind about a lot of things, and my mind needed to be changed. Absolutely. And then one day I was just worshiping, and the Lord's presence came in a very strong way, and it was a very sober, just a soberness that rested upon me. And the Lord said, "Get on your face." And I got on my face, and I was just waiting and praying in the Spirit. I learned to pray in the Spirit all the time. I'd wake up and I was praying in the Spirit. I'd go to sleep, I'm praying in the Spirit. I'm doing dishes, I'm praying in the Spirit. I learned to pray in the Spirit all the time. And so when I lay down on my face, stretched out like this, then the Lord touched my eyes. And I knew that my eyes were defiled and filthy. And I thought I was holy because I'm living in the secret place with Jesus. I'm spending all my time with him. But he touched my eyes. And my eyes were filthy. They were filled with the world, everything that I had looked at, everything I had not repented of and looked at and didn't even know. You see a billboard, flash. You see this, flash. You see that, this, this. You start a movie and go, oh my God, no, I didn't know it was that. All these things that I had seen were in my eye gates. And I began to sob and cry out, Jesus, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. Cover my eyes with your blood. And it was a sob, like you're talking about. There's no comfort. I was sobbing my guts out. Please cover my eyes with your blood. Forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. And then he touched my mouth, same thing. My ears, same thing. My belly, where judgment, opinions, criticism, bitterness, comparison, all those things live. I was wrecked. I was a sobbing mess. And once he had done that, he was quiet for a minute, and then just almost at the speed of light, came faces up in front of me. Faces of people I loved. And all I could say is, Jesus, have mercy, cover them with your blood. 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 He was showing me what real intercession is and what it means to really love somebody. And then one day, I was dancing with the globe, and the Lord had my hand, the palm of my hand, resting on India. And suddenly, I was in India. Now, I know that I was transported there, but that sounds ridiculous. But I know that I was. Whether in the body or out of the body, it does not matter to me. I just went with the Lord. So I have the globe, and I have India now just pressed into my gut, and I'm doubled over. And I'm sobbing, and suddenly I'm in India. And so when I'm in India, I'm walking up this reddish dirt road. There's a three-story brick building that is kind of dilapidated, and I see in the spirit right up to the third floor, and I see there are children in cages. So now I'm running. I'm not young, but I'm running. And I ran up the steps on the side of the building all the way in, and as I get into the room, it's dark, it stinks, and they are naked. And they are from here to about here. And they stand with vacant eyes in their own cages, sometimes two or three in a cage, sometimes bigger ones in a cage by themselves. They've been left to die because they were sex slaves. And because they're so sick now, nobody wants them. So they're going to starve to death right there, and that's going to be the end of them. There are millions and millions and millions and millions of those around the world. And so I start yelling at my father. And I'm screaming at him, give me the key, give me the key, give me the key. I'll open the gate, for each one of them. And so I'd open, suddenly I have a key in my hand. I'm opening, I'm pulling them out to me, and I'm holding them to me, going to get the next, until I have this little crowd of children around me, and I am sobbing, Father, I will love them, and they will know you. I will raise your sons and daughters from the ashes of India. Holy, 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 holy. And he broke my heart for the India bride. All those children, all those disposable lives, all those throwaways. Has anybody ever been a throwaway? My God, I've been a throwaway. Have you been a throwaway? Yes. Well, he didn't throw us away. And then he redeemed us so we could go for the throwaways. So as I'm sobbing, 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 suddenly I'm back in my worship room, and this time it's just snot flying, tears, I'm soaked, and the globe's in my gut. Now, you thought this was going to be fun, didn't you? It will in a minute. Holy. And I'm saying, was I just in India? Was I just there? Is this real? What is happening to me? He was breaking my heart and changing my mind and stripping away and equipping with love. Because he can. It's all his idea. And I remember the day that he said, "Beloved, I want you to go back to your bedroom tonight." That gal who walked up and down that little tiny hallway, just so upset and so terrified to go in, never wanted to go back to her bedroom. I didn't want to go back. And I cried, and I cried, and I cried. And he said, "Oh, beloved, I'll go with you." "You will?" "Yeah, I'll go with you." Then I remember when he began to send me out, and he would encounter the people that I would talk to. And prophetic words began to bubble up and come true. Bam, 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 bam. And I've been called to Africa, had these amazing prophecies for Africa, but I have not been to Africa. But he brought Africa to me. In my little hometown of Independence, he connected me with this African woman who had a Bible study on Friday nights. So there I'm with Burundi. There were five African nations, women and children, and a few men. And so I'm Mama Linda in the middle of Africa in East Independence. And I remember that on my birthday, the first woman who prayed over me prayed in Swahili. I was like, "Oh, is this happening?" And I remember the Lord telling me that he was going to take me to Africa. And I said, "Why would you do that?" This is back in 94 when I didn't have understanding of God's love. I said, "Why would you do that if I can't feed the poor? I can't raise the dead. Why would you do that? That would be a mean thing to do, Father." I said, "What could I possibly do?" He said, "You're going to love them with my love." It wasn't until I had spent that time alone with him that I knew that in his love is everything. Everything. There's healing. There's life. There's food, there's clothing, there's restoration, there's reconciliation. Everything is in God's love. God is love, and everything is in his love. His love conquers all. His love conquers death, it conquers famine, it conquers opinions, it criticism, it conquers religion. His love conquers all, and he was conquering me with his love. So he entrusted this African group to Mama Linda, who was learning how to love. And I'd get so drunk, I couldn't even stand up. We would worship for hours. I love to worship with African people. Man, they will go the distance, and I love that. And so we would worship until 2, 3, 4 in the morning, and then I'd find I'm the only one standing, and they couldn't get up because of the glory of our Father who came. We began to be a glory encounter as we worship the Lord. Do you want to be a glory encounter of your Heavenly Father? Then worship Him. Worship him. Worship when nobody's looking. Worship when you're not at church, you're not at a conference. Just worship. Walk around the house and just tell him, "I love you." And tell him why you love him, how good he is to you, what he's done for you that day. Just spend time, just sit and just be with him. And I guess my story is to tell you that on my 53rd birthday, he said to me, "I've waited 53 years of your life for this time in your life." And I said, "Oh, Jesus, I'm 60 now. Oh, Jesus, I am so sorry. I am so sorry." And he said, "Oh, beloved, you were worth the wait. You and me were worth the wait." He knows what it takes. He knows how he's taking us out of our past into our present, so the past is no longer what we carry, and then on into the future of knowing him. And my favorite passage of scripture, my favorite, go on to know the Lord. He comes as surely as the spring rain. He comes as surely as the dawn. Go on to know the Lord. Amen. I had a dream and a vision within the dream. Now that's pretty weird, right? But I had this right before Pentecost this year. And in the dream, I was in a room, and there were probably 50 people surrounding me, all in chairs. But I was sitting among everybody, and they said, "Come teach us, come teach us." So I stood up, and I looked at every one of them, and I said, "What are you looking at me for? Close your eyes and look at the one who is and was and ever shall be the Almighty God. Then I just closed my eyes. And then suddenly I'm down the hill from the foot of the cross, and there's one trickle of blood coming right to me. That's the vision within the dream. And as soon as it got to me, everyone in the room began to cheer out of their minds, worshiping the Lord. Let me unfold the dream and the vision for you. When people look to you, take yourself out of the picture and you look at Him. You just commune with Him and let the work of His blood. People talk about the cross, I talk about the blood. People talk about the cross, they sing about the cross. I talk about the blood. Without His blood, we have nothing. There's no hope apart from the blood of Christ covering us. There's no salvation. There's no redemption. There's no reconciliation. There's nothing apart from the blood of Jesus. John G. Lake, Mother Eder, Charles Finney, there are so many greats that I love. And when they wrote that when they would teach about the blood of Jesus and then they would sing about the blood of Jesus, it felt like Christ Himself walked out onto the platform and miracles broke out with nobody doing anything. Honor Him for His blood. Amen. He poured out His blood for us. And how blessed are the martyrs right now around the world whose blood is being poured out for their King. And all these children, everything. I got to tell you that when your time comes, if you are martyred, you won't be afraid. Right. You'll be with the one who's standing with you. In great love, great joy, great power. And even though your flesh is going to be cut down, your spirit will never fail. And your last breath will leave that body before anything touches you. Before your head is cut off or before your whatever it is, you're going to leave your body and you'll be with the Lord before you fall. That's the goodness of God. That's what happened to Stephen, right? It's exactly. And I notice how, because I know I died once. There's no pain. There's no suffering. But He brought me right back. Why did He do that? It wasn't time to go. You don't ever have to be afraid of going before it's time to go. He's never going to let you go before it's time to take the last breath. Your very last breath is purposed. And up until then, it's all purposed. It's all written in the book. Before the foundation of the world, your book was written. Before the foundation of the world, your book of life was written. Everything was written because with God, here's time, and He's before and after time and everything else. It's all written. Every decision we make, everything we've done, and what's been blotted out, everything we've repented for. So repent. Amen. Now I have really good news. God is love. He is holy and He is good. He is good beyond what we understand goodness to be because we have a carnal mind and we live in this world. But He is good. And He used to say to me, and still at times does say, "Beloved, ask me, I long to give to you." And I would say, "I don't know what to ask you for. I don't know what to ask you for, Jesus." And finally, I learned to say, "Put the questions in me. Whatever you want to give me, I want to ask you for that. I don't know. I'm short-sighted or something. I don't know. But whatever you want to do, Lord, I ask you for that." And I say, "Turn every no in me into a full-blown yes for you. Let there be no resistance in me for you." Then I began to pray. And like 1992, I'd say, "Lord, fill me with your glory and let your glory be revealed in me." Now, this is a mystery I'm going to share with you. For those who have ears to hear, hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Fill me with your glory and let your glory be revealed in me. Then I read in John 17, where Jesus is talking about the glory that He had, He has given to us. And we go back to Moses when he's hiding in the cleft of the rock and the Lord is passing by and wouldn't allow him to see his face, but he saw his back. And I believe with all my heart that Moses saw the crucified back of our Savior. I believe that's what he saw. And then fast forward in time, and there's Moses standing and Elijah standing beside the king as he's about to enter into his. And it's going to be the fulfilling time. So Moses came and Elijah came to comfort him, to strengthen him, and to love him. So if we've been filled with the same glory Jesus was filled with, what is this glory? He also said, "The love that you had for me, I have given to them." Well, what is the glory of God? It's that we would know Him. It's that we would love him. It's that we'd hold nothing from him. A few months ago, I was really upset about something, an issue in my family, and a beautiful great-granddaughter of mine, and I couldn't get out from under the issue. I would pray and pray and pray, and I woke up this morning with a vulture sitting on my head. Now, I see in the spirit, and I don't talk about that a lot, except to close people that I know to share things with, but he was on my head. I was lying, and he was vomiting on me. And what was he vomiting? Worry, dread, fear, hopelessness, anxiety, oppression. And so I said, Father, and he said, get up and dance. So I always had my music on, so I just went over and turned the speaker up, and it was Jesus Culture singing, Walk With Me, Jesus. Jesus, walk with me. And I went, well, that's appropriate. Jesus, dance with me. And so I'm trying to dance, but I'm just lumbering around the room. There's no dance in me. I'm too freaked out and too unhappy about the circumstances in this situation. And so I finally just laid down on the floor, grabbed a cover, and just covered me. I'm just laying on the floor, and I can't even pray. I'm so messed up. You ever been like that? Oh, yeah. It's the enemy. Yeah. So I'm laying on the floor, and I'm just, oh, Jesus, help me, help me, help me. And then I look in the spirit. My eyes are open. I see there's an angel kneeling beside me, and he's got both hands on my back right up here. And I said, what's he doing, Father? He said, he's giving you strength to surrender. And I went, oh. Didn't mean anything to me. I was in the middle of the mess. So I went on praying and praying and praying. And then pretty soon I'm surrendering everybody and everything. And then I'm off the floor. Then the music is on high praise. And I start dancing and singing and prophesying over my great-granddaughter and the people in these circumstances. And I went, wow, Lord, you turned me around. So then I asked him later, unpack this Holy Spirit. Where is it in the scripture that angels came to strengthen for surrender? You know what Jesus said to me? He said, I asked them if they would pray with me just 1 hour, and they went to sleep. And he said, and I went back to pray. And he said, and I didn't want to go to the cross. He didn't want to go to the cross. And he said, and I kept talking to my Father. And I was saying, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. And he said, and finally he just submitted himself and said, okay, not my will, but your will be done. And then the angels came and ministered to him. He said it was then that from his Father's throne, the angels came, touched him, imparted to him strength to walk it out. To walk it out. And so he did. But just because I saw the angel do that doesn't mean he's only done that for me. I'm sure that everybody in here has received strength from the throne to walk it out. And strength from the throne to surrender. Amen?
Amen.
What do we need to surrender tonight? Well, there's two things the Lord said for me to specifically look at. Our heart. The first commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. All your heart. My mind and strength. Jesus said the second one's like it, and love your neighbor as yourself. All these two, the law and the prophets, they're all there, right there. But we've loved cars. We've loved TV shows. We've loved chocolate. We've loved other people with all our heart. We've loved possessions. We've loved identity. We've loved power. We've loved all kinds of things with all of our heart, but Jesus said, no, love the Lord your God with all your heart, might, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Love the Lord. So he was telling me back in my worship room, you have a divided heart. And I thought, what? And so he was showing me, even my children I loved more than God. And he said, you've put everything else here, and then you have this little piece for me. So how can you love your neighbor as you love yourself if you only have this little piece, and I want you to love me with all of your being, all that you are? And so I began to repent. Then I began to get a love change. And my love that had criticism and hidden contracts and speculation and, you know, whatever, all that stuff, my love died. And he put his love in me so that I could love you unconditionally. Now we know I'm still in school with Holy Spirit. I'm still in the love school. I'm also still in the trusting God with all my heart, not leaning on my own understanding school. Anybody else in that class? I am totally, I'm there every day. I don't know how many times I'm going to, but yeah, thank you, Jesus, that he is the excellent teacher, and he's able to teach us. He speaks our language through every circumstance to teach us how to trust in the Lord with all of our heart and not lean on our understanding, and acknowledge him in all our ways. Amen. Let's pray in the Spirit for a minute, shall we? I want long, low sounds. Yeah. Paul, would you come and play also? Dire meria Señor en aia. Dina meria resora.
Pour out your spirit on each and every.
but you. Father, cut every string that the enemy has placed upon me. Every false responsibility, every false responsibility, every false burden, every false, dark, and perverse thing. Let Holy Spirit cover me. Come, Holy Spirit. Ungodliness. my motives. Forgive me, Lord. Forgive me, Lord. And I ask you, Jesus, to uproot every root of bitterness, all darkness and death in my belly, and take it from me, God. Do it tonight, Lord. Do it tonight between me and you, Holy Spirit. Do it tonight, God. Do it tonight. Don't leave me this way. Holy, holy, holy. Out of your belly will flow rivers of living water in Jesus' name. Not sweet and bitter rivers, but I say the river of Holy Spirit will flow from your bellies in Jesus' name. If that's what you want, say, do it, Father! Do it, Father! Lord, put your hand on your mouth. Lord, let this be an instrument of your word. Let your fire pour forth through this mouth, this tongue, this breath. Let it be my breath with the Spirit of Holy Spirit and no other spirit. Let it be the fire of God and no strange fire in my mouth. In Jesus' name, say, forgive me for using my words to break your will in the lives of others by curses and the ungodly things I have spoken, even in passing. Forgive me. Let my mouth be an instrument of your peace. Let my mouth be an instrument of reconciliation, the good news of the gospel, the healing virtue of Christ flowing through me. Use me, God. Use me, God. And this pedestal, this altar that I have built for myself in my mind, I ask you to forgive me. Jesus, you said, don't think of yourself more highly than you should. Forgive me that I put myself on a platform or that I put myself beneath. Forgive me that I have exalted or ridiculed myself. Forgive me. Whatever applies to you, it's all pride. It's all pride. Jesus, let it be unto me according to your word. May I know you. And may I know whose I am and be. Me to be who you won and paid the price for me to be. Let me be that one. Let me live in my inheritance under your blood, by the power of your Spirit, in your name and for your glory. In Jesus' name, say, do it, God. Do it, God. Do it, God. Do it, God. Now here's the second part that he gave me for you. Are you ready? I'm ready. Okay, come down just a bit, because I'm yelling. Okay, so our imagination is a gift from God. Our imagination was given to us to imagine what we cannot see, right? The enemy infiltrated our imagination with Adam and Eve in the garden. And so we've been walking with a fallen nature in our imagination too. How could Jesus only see what he saw the Father doing? He was looking through an unblemished vessel in his imagination. He could see into the future. He could see into the next moment. He could see into millennia ahead, right? We can too, if we guard our imagination. Guard your imagination. So tonight, he wants to give you a bloodbath in your imagination. Do you want one? I know it's one of my favorite things when I pray for people individually is to pray over their imagination. And then we're going to pray over your name. Glory. We're having a bath tonight. Don't you love a good bath on a 113-degree day? Whatever this has been. Okay, so we've imagined fear. We've imagined terrible things happening. We got mad at somebody and imagined something we shouldn't imagine for them. We've imagined the uh-oh, the what-ifs. We've imagined and it brought us anxiety and fear and hopelessness. If you listen to the news just one time, it's feeding your imagination. You got to guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You got to guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Don't let the enemy have your mind. Don't let him have your imagination. Don't let him have your ear gaze. If you're listening to someone who's lying, turn away and have nothing to do. Pray for them, but do not let lies live in you. When Jesus said, the enemy of my soul is coming, but he has nothing in me, he meant, there is no darkness found in the King of Glory. So the enemy had no way to buffet him. So we know he presided over his own death and resurrection. Amen? But we have agreed with the enemy. In our imagination, all the other things that we've, some of the other things we've addressed. The enemy will buffet your dreams. He'll give you fear and nightmares. He'll give you false dreams. He'll give you false words. He'll give you false, because he's the father of lies. There's no truth in him. So if your imagination is in darkness in any way, if there's even a spot, the enemy has room to move. If he has room to move, he has room to speak. If he has room to move, room to speak, he has room to create, because we are co-creators with Christ. If we begin to speak something, it's already being created. If we are thinking, our thoughts are substance, it's already being created. Everything is substance. Our thoughts, our words, our deeds. Everything is substance. Everything is alive. We must create with Christ. Remember when Jesus said to me, beloved, you have to know who your Father is and only speak His language, only His language. So those things like a lot, you know, slang words that I used to use that weren't cuss words, they gotta go. He kept saying for a couple years, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Not heck no or heck yes. He said, let your yes be yes. And he was teaching me, come out of unholiness, come out of ungodly ties. And man, that was a constant thing about my language. And he still will rest on me. I go, oh, I just said a thing. I'm sorry, Jesus. But Holy Spirit is relentlessly loving us to the truth. He will not be stopped. Holy Spirit is a teacher who will not be stopped. He will not be thwarted. He will not back up. He will not step aside. But he will work in every circumstance and in every way to bring us into the holy highway for our Lord. Amen. Father, forgive me for ungodly imaginations. I have surely done it. I ask you to help me, to deliver me, to put a guard in my heart, to renew the discerning by your Spirit within me, my sensitivity to the discerning of your Spirit. Put it in your words, but you have to be renewed in the sensitivity to discern when you're imagining the wrong thing. Renew. Give us a new sensitivity to your presence concerning our imaginations, that we will no longer just blindly go with the enemy, but we will listen to you and say, that's not God. I refuse it. I rebuke it. I take it captive and put it under the blood of Jesus. When a thought comes to you and it's not good, you just say, Father, I put that under the blood of Jesus. And then it does not become a stronghold and part of your DNA, but it goes under the blood and is powerless to rise up. Doesn't mean the enemy won't keep coming. It means it has no power right now. You keep guarding, he keeps getting defeated. You keep guarding, he keeps getting defeated. Resist the devil and he will flee. Father, now I ask you, cleanse my imagination with the blood of Jesus. Make my imagination holy. Fill my imagination with the light of Christ. Let me imagine with the living Word made flesh. I give you free reign of my imagination, Holy Spirit. Show me what you want to show me. Take me where you want to take me. Create through me what you want to create through me. I give you all of me, including my imagination. I say yes to you, God. Yes, make me holy. As you are holy, Jesus, make me holy, holy, holy. Tell him, you guys, tell him. If it's in your heart, make me holy. If you have the slightest desire, say, fill me with desire to be holy. If you don't have the desire, say, fill me with the desire to guard my thoughts. Fill me with the desire to spend my life on you. Fill me with desire to get to know you, to give you time. Fill me with desire for you. Thank you. Something that is so exciting. exciting and so good. You are His beloved. Everywhere you go, somebody needs the one inside of you. The Jesus inside of you isn't a miniature. The Holy Spirit inside of you isn't tiny. The Lord who loved you sent Himself to you. And when you said yes to Him, He's been working in your life to bring you into the fullness of relationship with Him. And that's why you're here tonight, to hear what I had to say, because it was my little life with Him. But you have a little life with Him too. Amen? Give Him away. Give Him away. Give Him away. I'm not just talking about feeding the poor. I'm not just talking about raising the dead. I'm saying everywhere you go, when you look upon something, you can talk to the Lord about that one. When someone's standing in front of you, Father, what do you want me to know? What do you want me to do? Give Him away. The more you give Him away, the more you will know Him. And the more of Him will come back to you until it's multiplied, pressed down, shaken, and running over, and you won't even have room to contain Him. And then He will overtake your life. And then you'll walk through a room with the presence of God surrounding you. I'm going to tell you this one last thing. I think it's the last thing. I don't know. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said. I don't know what it is. It was when I was in the secret place with the Lord those 2 years, and He'd been saying to me, "Beloved, I'm going to bring you up and take you in." And I was getting so excited. He's going to bring me up and take me in. I knew He was talking about heaven. He's going to bring me up and take me in. He said, "I'm going to bring you up and I'm going to take you in. And you're going to look into my eyes of fire." So He said, "You're going to look into my eyes of fire." Now, I've seen the Lord many times, but I'd never seen Him with eyes of fire. He said, "You're going to look into my eyes of fire." Now, we know that's the Ancient of Days. We know that's Jesus the Christ in the book of Revelation. He is who He is. And He said, "I'm going to twinkle my fire into your eyes. And that fire that is me is going to come into you, and that fire will never go out." I was just so excited. I was waiting. Days, weeks, months went by. He was preparing me for that trip. And then one day He did it. And as I was standing, I was immediately standing in heaven outside of a big, beautiful gate. And I was looking around. It was so beautiful. And then I heard the Lord say to me, "My beloved is a locked garden." And as soon as I heard that, everything in me went, "Jesus!" And I threw the gate open and ran to Him. And as soon as I got to Him, He's standing and I'm seeing His eyes of fire. He's looking down into my eyes. And I knew that 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 He was, is, and always will be God. My brain that couldn't figure it out was blown apart. I was forever impacted with the eternity of my King. There's only one. He is Father, and He is Son, and it's His Spirit. There's only one. There's not three people walking around in heaven. There's one God. "Behold, Israel, the Lord our God, He is one." And I was standing in front of Him as He's looking into my eyes, and that fire is blazing. And that fire was so many colors and so powerful, I never wanted to look at another thing as long as I lived. I wanted to stay right there and look into His eyes forever. I understand why the seraphim are flying around the throne, looking down and going, "Holy!" Because they're seeing something new about Him every second. And so then he imparted that fire into my eyes and into me. And such a love came into me. I have never been the same. I have never been the same, and I cannot stop crying out to become love as He is love. Now, if you've received my Jesus through me tonight, that fire already burns in you. If you have received my King through me tonight, like He said, that fire will never go out forever. It will never go out. Now, we know there are people in heaven, some that are much quieter and full of His glory than others. And you know why that difference is? Because there are those that live on the earth to know Him, and there are those that live on the earth just to have salvation. Right? We go from glory to glory to glory. Where do you want to be? Where do you want to be? Want to be with the Lord? Yeah. Go from glory to glory to glory. I bless you all. Give each other a hug. God bless you. God bless you.